Well, good morning. Welcome to the Huntsville United Methodist Church. I am so glad to see everyone here today. If you are new or a visitor or the first time here, again, welcome. If you need any more information on the Huntsville United Methodist Church, please feel free to check out the tables in the hallway and ask anyone, the pastor or myself, if you have any questions. But anyway, welcome. Glad you're here. Just a few announcements before we get started. The flowers on the altar today are in celebration of Sherry Thomas's birthday, and they're given by her family. This is not in the bulletin, so if you have a pen, you might want to write this down. We have coming up three service opportunities for you to participate in. The first one is this coming Tuesday is our daily bread at 4:30 at the Chippewa Park. So if you know where that is, and if you're available Tuesday at 4:30, please join in on that. Matthew 25 Ministries is coming up on the 28th. So again, write that down if you're involved in or interested in Matthew's 25 Ministries. Jot that down. If you're curious as to what that is, ask Ashley, and she'll be happy to tell you about that. And the third one is, just as a reminder, for Turning Point on our Wednesday nights, we usually provide dinner for the kids. There are several dates throughout the fall and the winter that are still kind of open, so if you feel like cooking up a bunch of grub for the kids of the church, again, get with Ashley and she'll help you out, fill in the schedule, fill in the calendar for food. Continuing on, there is Junior Jam scheduled at Cedarville College, Cedarville University. That is on October the 14th program for youth through third grade and through the sixth grade, I guess, from the third grade to the sixth grade. Anyway, put that on your calendar, read more about it in your bulletin. And one last thing, don't let the weather fool you. Christmas is right around the corner. What, like 3 months away or something like that? So again, a reminder in the bulletin, take a look at the information on the musicals. We're going to try to put together two musicals for this Christmas. Read the information, sign up, be active. Are there any other announcements? Yes, ma'am. Okay. Thank you. In case you didn't hear, our daily bread, right? Or the food pantry. Food pantry, the baskets are empty. She's already taken the food up, so please refill the baskets for the food pantry. Any other announcements? If not?
Thank you, Ron. Let's all stand as we begin our worship this morning with Good, Good Father. Let's stand as we sing.
Thank you. But don't sit down just yet, gang. Good morning. It is good to see everybody in the Lord's house today. Something we're going to talk about later on is that the King loves to see his house filled up. This is a beautiful sight. So as we get ready to bring ourselves before God and in this body, let's just bow our heads and have a word of prayer. Indeed, God, it is a good, good thing to be in the presence of the good, good Father. And today, God, we just bring ourselves here, ready to receive from you, ready to be fed, ready to be lifted up, to be strengthened, to find comfort, to find peace, all those things that the world tries to steal away from us and strangle out of us, God. We come back here just to allow your Spirit to pour into us now. So in the time we have here this morning, God, do great things in us that we could leave here and do great things for you in this world that desperately needs more of you. God, we open ourselves, we open this service, we open this church to the inpouring of your Spirit. Let your presence be felt. Let it be thick today. Let your grace just fill this all, fill this room, and fill all who are here, God. We're so grateful to have this opportunity to worship with you and to worship you alone. We offer this to you now in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. We all said and agreed? Amen.
Ushers, please come forward. Let's pray. Dear God, as we continue to prepare our hearts for worship today, we give thanks to you, and we give thanks to you, and we just freely give to you these tithes and offerings. Please, Lord, use these tithes and offerings to further your kingdom here on earth. It's in your Son's name we pray this morning. Amen. Thank you.
you look so big, goodness gracious. How are you? How are you? Are you being shy? You gonna be my helper? Oh, you do? Well, come on up. How are you? Come on over. Don't be shy. Do you want me to come over by you? Now I'm really embarrassing you, aren't I? Okay, I'll stop. All right, how are you guys this morning? Oh my goodness, school is just sucking your energy right out of you, isn't it? How are you guys this morning? Should we make them do it again? That was really sad, wasn't it? How are you this morning? Okay, last time. How are you this morning? All right, we'll let that one pass this time, okay? Hey, listen, I brought some special things with me this morning, and these are some of Tyson's favorite things that him and I really enjoy doing together. Anybody know what this is or what these books are? What is this? What do you think? What is this? What is it? A library. Good guess. Try again. These all three have something in common. What do you think? They all have something that you find. You're right. These are I Spy books, and this is an I Spy jar, okay? On the bottom, there's a list of things that you're supposed to spy in this jar. And so what we do, we say, I spy with my little eye, and then you find whatever it is, okay? We have the Thomas the Train one. This is one of his favorites. This is a Christmas one, and you have to spy different things, okay? So let's try it here in the sanctuary. Are you ready? Miss Ashley's going to spy something, and I want to see if you guys can find it. Are you ready? I spy with my little eye something brown. No. She got it. Laura got it. It's the cross behind you. All right, let's try it one more time. I spy with my little eye something black. I spy with my little eye something black. Adam, what? No, good guess. Good guess. You're close. What's back there? What is that? The piano, okay? Well, listen, the reason I brought this I Spy stuff is I believe the game of I Spy has to do with this special verse, okay? Listen up closely. This is from James 1:17. Can you guys say James 1:17? Listen closely. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights. Again, it says every good and perfect gift is coming from above, down from the Father of the heavenly lights, okay? So what I want to change that phrase, can you guys point to your eye? Point to your eye. I want you to say, I spy with my little eye a good and perfect gift from my Father. Let's try it together. I spy with my little eye a good and perfect gift from my Father. I believe that the Bible gave us this verse because it's one of the major keys of life. To go through life, it can be hard sometimes, but if every day we get up and we make it our job to spy with our little eye good and perfect gifts from above, it fills our hearts with hope, joy, and peace, okay? It's a gift that God wants you to have, all right? So let's try it one more time. What do we spy with our little eye? Are you ready? I spy with my little eye a good and perfect gift from my Father. So that's my challenge for you guys this week, is to look around and spy with your little eye a good and perfect gift, such as we're worshiping freely in this sanctuary, such as many of your family members are here healthy with you and love is flowing, all those types of things. Are you guys up for the challenge? All right, I want you to spy with your little eye, okay? Let's bow our heads and pray. God, you are so, so good. I thank you for this beautiful day that you have provided us, God. And I thank you so much for this verse from James, God. Help us remember how important it is, Lord, to get up every day and spy with our little eye all of the good and perfect gifts that you give us, God, such as waking us up in the morning, God, such as community and fellowship, God, food, protection, shelter, clothing, God. Help us view all of the gifts, Lord, and help us remember to keep our eyes casted on that and spy with our little eye all the good and perfect gifts that you bless us with each hour, God. Help us focus in on that, Lord, not the other things that distract us from the gifts that you give us each and every day. God, be with all of our youth ministry today, God, all the way from the nursery clear to our oldest kiddo back in junior church and be with each of the teachers and volunteers. We love you so much, Jesus. And together we said, peace out, my spy friends.
I think Ashley just gave the entire congregation something to do this week. In spite of all that we see going on in the world and the negativity and the hurt and the grief and the pain, I think we ought to make the effort to spy some things that are good and lift it up. Can I get an amen in the house? All right, all right. Well, friends, we're going to get ready for a time of prayer, but before we do, I've got a few things I just want to work through. I have a thank you note here. And, you know, Joyce lost her cousin Butch, and before he died, we had done a prayer quilt. And Butch and Billy, his wife, they wrote a little thank you note, and I want to share it with you. So this is kind of vintage Butch anyway. So here we go. Dear friends, from the bottom of our hearts, we thank you so much for the beautiful quilt. I must tell you, it is positioned where my husband can see it every time his eyes are open. And I must confess, though he'd probably be looking at the two of the prettiest girls who delivered it. P.S. I guess we've always known them as girls, but should have said women, or in Butch's words, he would have called them hot chicks. And of course, that was Ashley and Suzanne Gillespie that delivered it. And so he always would call them the hot chicks. I don't say that, not here. I'm just quoting that, all right? Don't want to get in trouble. So then I want to move to a couple other things. Let me just start with the good news. Natasha. Natasha is great with child. You are great with child. And you are going to be delivering that child this week. And so I want us to keep Dustin and Natasha and the whole family in our prayers. And your child's name, Brooks, is going to be entering this world on Wednesday. So thoughts and prayers go with you for this exciting occasion. So then on a little different note, that was joy. And there's an element of joy to what I'm going to say, but there's also grief and sadness that we speak of in this time. But I see Barb over here, and this is Dixie's daughter. Dixie went home to be with the Lord this week as well, Saturday morning, correct? And it looks like we're going to be hosting services here later on this week. You'll finish making the arrangements. Just keep an eye out on social media and in the newspaper for the final arrangements. But thoughts and prayers go with you, Barb, and the rest of your family as we say goodbye to Dixie. On that note, yesterday we said goodbye to David Smith here. We had his services at the church, the meal afterwards. Thank you to all who participated and helped send David off to heaven to be with his father up there. And then finally, I just received message just prior to coming out here that Dot Jacobs was taken to the hospital, so we want to keep Dot in our prayers as well. So those are the prayers that I wanted to lift it up. Thank you to everyone who has filled these out. Some really important things. Just one I would lift up is, you know, praying for world peace in the midst of some real crazy times. This bantering and saber rattling going on with North Korea is enough to unnerve. And you know what? We serve a good, good Father who is looking down upon us, who loves us, and who cares for us. And that's what we're going to put our trust in. Come what may, we're just going to trust in God. Is there an amen to that? Amen. Amen indeed. Let's bow our heads. Let's have a word of prayer. Well, you know, God, it is it's almost strange how we can spend so much of our time and how much of our lives we might spend looking for acceptance and just looking for a place to belong. And make no mistake, God, those are really important things in life, to find a sense of acceptance, to know we can walk into a place and feel like we belong. Those two elements are crucial for a healthy life, God. But forgive us when we look for that acceptance and we look for that belonging in all the wrong places, And forgive us when we go looking for that in the wrong crowds. And rather remind us this morning, God, that in your presence, in your house, we finally have what we've been looking for. This is where we belong. And when we come into your presence, God, make no mistake, this is where we find true acceptance. And we find that not because we're so great, or because we've done wonderful things, or we've given to this degree or that degree. We're not accepted here because of who we know or what we know. But rather, God, we are accepted here because we walked into your presence. And your word, your scriptures tell us that, God, you loved us first. And you proved that by death on a cross for us. So our response is that we love you because you first loved us. And now, God, here this morning, we are at a place where our souls can finally say, we're home. We're home. And we are. So now, God, let your grace fall upon us once more as we celebrate this time in worship and communion with you this morning. God, we offer ourselves and this congregation and this church and these prayers to you now in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, along with all the prayers of our people. And today we pray for the family of Dixie. We pray for Natasha and Dustin and for their fourth child, Brooks, this week. We pray for the family of David Smith and for Dot. And likewise, God, we lift up to you Roger and Sharon Blank. We pray for the Cook family, for Karen, Steve, Brittany, and Dustin, as well as Andy, Mary, and Katie. We give to you Miss Mackey, Teresa, and Rick, as well as Randall, Nathan. We pray for Tom, Bob, and Loretta, as well as Kim, Helen, Pat, and Donna. We pray for Gavin, Janet, and Ted, as well as Charles, and the family of Lori Caldwell. We pray for Gerald and Ann, for Mike and the boys, as well as for Gold Star Mothers in September. And then, God, we just can't escape it. But we'd pray for some kind of shift in the thinking, in the understanding of this world. What I'm driving at, God, is I pray for peace. Isaiah dreamt of a day when swords would be beaten into plowshares, and when lions and lambs would rest together. And God, I think I speak for weary souls today. And I pray that things change in our world. It just seems to be growing darker and darker. So God, do what only you can do. Let darkness be turned into light. And let it happen through the power and the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. And let that power and light flow through us, that we would be transparent to you, and that we would spend our days and our time looking for your goodness in this world and then lifting it up. And as we lift that up, we would lift the cross high, that all would be drawn unto you. This is what we pray today, God, and this is how we pray it. We do it in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, who taught us all to pray together and aloud in one common voice. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Amen indeed. All right, well, friends, if you have your Bibles with you, I want to invite you to open up to the Gospel of Luke and go to the 14th chapter. We're going to read verses 15 through 24, and we're going to be wrapping up our series today called Seeds. And You know, 5 weeks ago, we talked about how important it was for us as God's people to take the seeds of the gospel, to take the seeds of the good news out into the world and to cast them. And it doesn't matter where it falls. Our responsibility is to just keep casting those seeds. The people would hear the good news and they would respond to the good news and lives would be changed. And this is an honorable thing. And this is the work that is worthy of the kingdom. And this work is worthy of our time and our effort. And so today, as we get ready to wrap this up, we're going to hear about a banquet, a party that's being thrown, and people are invited to it. And some people turn it down, and then the guest list gets rewritten, and people show up. And what an amazing event this is. And, you know, I'm going to speak more into this as we go, but you know what? People are going to turn down invitations to this. It's been happening since the beginning of time. God extends an invitation, and people just turn it down. But that should not detract from your work to keep inviting, to keep casting seeds. There's a party being thrown by our Father in heaven. The kingdom banquet is set. We're freely invited to come be a part of it. So with that as a backdrop, I want you to hear this parable that Jesus tells about this party. From the Gospel of Luke chapter 14, verses 15 through 24, hear now the word of God. One of the dinner guests, on hearing this, said to him, "Blessed is anyone who will eat bread in the kingdom of God." Then Jesus said to him, "Someone gave a great dinner and invited many. At the time for the dinner, he sent a slave to say to those who had been invited, 'Come, for everything is ready now.' But they all alike began to make excuses. The first said to him, 'I've bought a piece of land, and I must go out and see it. Please accept my regrets.' Another said, 'I've bought 5 yoke of oxen, and I'm going to go try them out. Please accept my regrets.' Another said, 'I have just been married, therefore I cannot come.' So the slave returned and reported this to the master. Then the owner of the house became angry and said to his slave, 'Go out at once into the streets and the lanes of the town and bring in the poor and the crippled, the blind and the lame.' And the slave said, 'Sir, what you have ordered has been done, and there is still room.' Then the master said to the slave, 'Go out into the roads and the lanes and compel people to come in so that my house may be filled. For I tell you, none of those who were invited will taste my dinner.'" Here ends this reading, and all who hear the word of God will be blessed. Amen? All right. So, well, having been married to my beautiful bride for over 20 years now, I can safely say to you, she and I are both way out of touch with the whole dating scene. At least I hope you are. And if not, then I'm the last to know about it, but I'm just a sucker anyway. I say that because recently I read an article, a little thing in one of the psychology journals about the psychology of, are you ready for this? Being stood up on a date. All right. Now there is a fun little topic to talk about this morning. For anybody who has ever dated, and that includes most of us, at some time or another, we all thought to ourselves, "I want to get in the dating game." So you jump into the dating game, and then this cruel event happens. I mean, think about it, the elements of the date. You put on a real nice outfit, you get all cleaned up, right? You look in the mirror, you make sure you're ready to go. And you know what? You hope against hope because you think to yourself, maybe this is the person who God is going to lead me to and changes my life. This might be Mr. or Mrs. Perfect. And you have this dream, like, you know what, we're going to go out and the conversation is just going to flow. We're going to talk. It's just words are going to roll off our lips. We're going to look into each other's eyes and we're going to know soulmates instantly. Right? I think that's met with some skepticism. But then it happens. You get stood up. And here's what the article was really talking about. This in this day and age, when people get stood up, there's something else going on. See, when a person gets stood up, they talk to these people, and they said, you know, I would text these persons. I would Facebook message these persons. I would email them. I would try and call them. And it's as if they don't even exist anymore. And psychiatrists and sociologists have a new term for this. It's called ghosting. And when they went in and looked a little bit about, like, why do they call it ghosting? Why is this happening? What they're discovering is that in this day and age when people are dating, it happens more and more from online social media kind of sites. And the thinking is people don't necessarily look at other people as people anymore when you're getting ready to date. All you think of them is as a profile on the computer. And because of that, if you change your mind and decide, I don't want to date this person, you just disappear. You don't have to respond. You don't have to respond. And people talk about how painful this is and how awkward it is, because sometimes they might actually run into this person and see them and they ignore them. And they say, it's because we just are dealing with profiles these days. So I don't know if you've ever been ghosted. If you have, I'm sorry, because it's a lonely place to be. People talk about it's a little humiliating, and you realize this is just a new way of describing an old tactic. I got stood up on a date. Now, this is a painful and sometimes embarrassing event, but have you ever thought about what this would look like on, say, a more corporate level? Let's say this. Let's just say for the sake of discussion today. You decided to throw a party, and you got all the elements in place. And on the day and the time of the party, when the doors opened up, nobody came. You just got stood up by everybody. And the question then becomes, what do you do when you're ready for a party and nobody shows up? All your guests turn you down and stand you up. What do you do? This is the dilemma that Jesus talks about today in the parable of the banquet. Now, I just want to unpack this a little bit. If you look at the corollary gospel accounts, they refer to the person throwing the event not just as the master, but as the king. There was a king who decided to throw a party. And I like calling this person the king. I just happen to use the gospel of Luke where they called him the master. So the king decides to throw a party. And what's he do? He has the fatted calves killed. He unrolls these big, fine barrels of wine, uncorks them, gets the table set, gets the chairs out. The invitations were cast. And when it was time for the party to go down, nobody shows up. Nobody shows up. For all intents and purposes, the king got stood up. The king doesn't like this. He gets upset. It says so in the account. The king got upset. So he called for his servants and says, you know what? I need you to go out and remind everybody, I'm having a party right now, right here. The place is rocking. The whole house is rocking. So the servants go out and they track down the people who were given the invitation. And I know this would never happen to good Methodist people, but all the people who were invited gave excuses as to why they weren't there. Never happened in a Methodist church, right? Good people. But think about it. The ones like, no, I just bought 5 new oxen, and I've got to go test plow them out. We're going to go turn dirt. You know, the other one I got a kick out of was, hey, dude, I just got married, and I had no idea my spouse would be so demanding of my time. Please accept my regrets. I can't make it today. So the king is just heartbroken over this. Nobody shows up to his party. The king thinks to himself, all right, I'm not done. I'm the king. I got another move up my sleeve. The king is not dead just yet. So he sends his servants back out into the street to find some people who might really be interested and who might want to partake in the king's generosity and the king's hospitality. Only this time, the guest list gets changed, and it takes upon a radical change in nature. So let's look at this. Patrick, draw this up. Verse 21. The king says to his servant, go out at once into the streets and the lanes of the town and bring in, look who he says, the poor, the crippled, the blind, the lame. Now you think about that. Those people weren't the ones who were on that original guest list. This is a radically different guest list. The poor, the lame, the crippled, the blind. People who don't typically get invited to parties, at least by a king. But this king is rethinking things. And he says, go out into the streets. Go out in all the nooks and crannies. Bring me the poor. Bring me the crippled. Bring me the blind. Bring me the lame. And you know what? It doesn't end there. Because once these new guests arrive, the new guest list gets written, and all the new guests start to show up, the one servant says to the king, hey, boss man, we still got room. Your house is not full. And the king, if I could paint a mind's picture on you, I see the king, and there's this light bulb that goes off over his head. Ding! We still got room? So then notice what the king says next. Pull this one up, Patrick. All right, if I still got room, listen, go out into the roads and the lanes and compel people to come in. And look what he says, so that my house may be filled. Friends, I want to tell you something. The king likes to see his house, his ballroom, his castle. He likes to see it filled with his people. Now, I want you to know, I highlighted some words there and something in this. And the first one where I linger is I see the word compel. Now, you know, to compel somebody is to really make the interesting argument as to why this is worth your time and worth your effort and why you'd want to be here. And the king says, listen, go out and compel the people. Explain to them what I have going on here. Listen, I fatted the calf. I killed the fatted calves. We have beef tenderloin. I'll take a beef tenderloin steak, you know. I got potatoes. Compel them. I got great wine. I mean, this is the finest wine I've saved for everybody. Come in. We'll have our fill. We've got song and dance. You are going to be so welcome. Now, doesn't that compel you to want to come be a part of it? It's a lot different than if I were to come say to you, I'm going to go to a party. No, okay, fine. It doesn't work that way. Our arguments can and should be compelling when we're talking about coming to the king's party. Because the king likes to see his house filled. So, the house gets filled up. And I want you to remember this as we go forward. The king likes to see the house full. So for a moment, if I take a step back from this and I just kind of articulate it theologically for us and put it in the first century working context of what this was, Jesus is telling a parable because the people who had been chosen, God's chosen people, the Jewish race, they were rejecting Jesus, right? And so when Jesus tells this parable and he talks about the king is God. And God's people are rejecting him. And so God says, you know what? That's all right. If my people want to reject me, I will send my son and I will draw people in from all the other corners. It doesn't matter. I will find a way to fill it up. The guest list is getting rewritten right before our eyes. And Jesus says, you know what? The king wants to have people in his company who is grateful, who understands the working of grace and how God's grace is being extended to them. God realizes, I want people who can come into the house and who understand greater things are yet to come, but we'll celebrate the good stuff that we got right here and right now. And more importantly, what Jesus is making the argument about is there's room for all of you at the table. There's room for all of you in the king's quarters. Not because of what you've done, not because of who you are, but because of what God is doing. There is room for you in the king's quarters. He has a place for you. And when you get there, you just might be surprised who you find standing beside you. The king likes to rewrite guest lists. And you just might find the person standing beside you is someone that you never thought you'd see. And the person standing beside you in the king's quarters just might be someone you don't even think is worthy to be in the king's presence. But never underestimate the move of the king. It's his quarters. It's his kingdom. It's his guest list. Reminds me of a story I read not too long ago about a 25-year-old pharmacy student from Purdue University named Sarah Cummins. She had her big wedding day back in July of this year. And for 2 years, Sarah, while being a pharmaceutical student, saved and scrimped and worked and did everything she could, and she saved $30,000 to go towards this wedding for her and her fiance, and she was so excited about it, as most ladies are. I mean, I don't mean to be stereotypical here, but when couples come into my office and they're going to get married, I just turn the material over to the women. The guys just stand there and sit there, and they just shake their heads. Yes, this is the way it works really well. I see all the guys smiling. I see all the ladies looking at me with sharp eyes. All right. So Sarah's working so hard to get this wedding, get all the arrangements in place. She's got the dresses, she's got the tux, she's got the Ritz Charles in Carmel, Indiana reserved. She's got the invitations sent out, the musicians, the DJ. She's got the preacher all hooked up, all right? You don't want to have a wedding without the preacher. And most importantly, she's got herself a groom. At least she thought she had herself a groom. 1 week. 1 week before the wedding was to take place this July, she found herself without a groom. Her and the groom separated for what she called undisclosed reasons. You can connect the dots. I don't know. It was undisclosed reasons. All I know is they got out 1 week from their wedding, and all the plans got changed. And here's the deal. Everything had been paid for. That $30,000 she had saved for, scrimped for, had worked for 2 years on, it had all been spent. It had all been put in place. And do you know when you're 1 week out from a wedding, do you know how likely you are to get a refund for that money? Yeah, you're going to get about zero, right? I mean, the safe thing is I don't let people pay me until like the day before. So she got her money sent back from the preacher. An act of grace. So Sarah personally does what she has to do in this moment. She picks up the phone and she calls all the invited guests, all 175 of them, and explains through tears and embarrassment that there's been a change of plans and they're canceling the wedding, and she doesn't, whoever she's talking to, you don't need to come to the wedding now. And midway through this, as she's calling and crying and canceling, a new idea begins to hatch in her head. She thinks to herself, I would hate to see $30,000 go down the drain. It's already been spent. I'm not getting the first penny of it back. So she hatches this new idea, and she thinks to herself, what if I just create a new guest list? What if I just invite some other people? So she reaches out to the homeless shelters in her community and explains, listen, I've got the Ritz reserved. I got a DJ in place. I got musicians. I got food. Man, I got like all kinds of food you wouldn't believe. I've got hors d'oeuvres. I mean, I've got, and you know what? I would like to invite the homeless people of our community to a big honking party that I'm going to throw. And in 1 week's time, some other people, some other business leaders caught wind of this, and so they decided to hook up these homeless people with new dresses and new suits to come to this party. They got limos, they got escorted, and they began to have a really hopping time. Matter of fact, I got a picture of Sarah Cummins with some of her new guests. Patrick, let's pull this up. There's the bride. Look at that smile. And if you look closely, you'll see her grandmother in there as well. And here they are having a party. I mean, it was an evening of smiles and of laughter. And people who weren't on the original guest list, they found themselves as recipients of this incredible act of grace. And as you look at Sarah, and as I look at Sarah, I can't help but think that maybe just somewhere in the midst of that week of cries and heartbreak, maybe she heard the whispers of a king say to her, go compel my people to be a part of what I'm doing. I want to see my house filled. Go compel my people. Thank you, Patrick. You can take that down. You know, in the same way, friends, there is a place at God's table for you. There is room in the quarters of the king for you. This king went to great lengths to add you to his guest list, to make sure you're a part of what's happening, not just here and now, but to prepare you for what's going to come at the real banquet where we feast with the king himself. And this table we talk about, and this ballroom that we talk about, this is a place open for all who want something better in life. For those who have felt the sting of a very cruel world that has stood you up in one way or another, guess what? There's another place to come and behold a new world of blessings. This is a place to find blessings. There is a place where grace is served up. It's like the main entree. And this king is serving a wild cocktail of grace and mercy and forgiveness. And he says, you can drink from it freely. I've made it just for you. Gratitude, second chances, that's like the dessert on this menu. And the king says, I just want you to come, and I want to be the one to compel you to come be a part of it, to come be a part of it. You have every reason to come here and be a part of what the king is up to. His mercy endures forever. And so as I draw this to a conclusion here today, I want to go and I want to make a little bit of a connection. As I said in the preface of this, when we started, we talked about how God says, you're responsible for scattering seeds of my kingdom. And these seeds are invitations to come be a part, to be a part of what we're doing here in the local church, to be a part of preparations of what's going to happen in the kingdom yet to come. And Jesus even talked about all the different soil types and says, you're going to cast an unequivocally large amount of seeds and you're going to get just a small return on it. Jesus was very clear about that. And he says, it doesn't matter. You keep casting the seeds. You keep inviting people. As Jesus would tell in this parable today, you go out into the streets. You go out into the lanes. You go out into the country. You compel people to come be a part of this because it is worth your time. It is worth your effort. The king is doing great things. Now, I would only affirm now what Jesus said, and that is, you will be rejected by a lot of people. Matter of fact, I got some feedback last week when we had National Back to Church Sunday. Some people felt so bad because they invited so many people and every one of them rejected them. Said, man, I got other plans. It's kind of like they were saying, well, I just bought new oxen. I'm going to go plow a field. You know. Yeah. Excuses all work the same. It doesn't matter the century. Know this, Jesus says, you're going to experience a lot of rejection along the way. But don't let that stop you. Don't let that stop you. There's so much more to live for. There's so much more to have to happen. And I don't know about you, but I got to tell you, by the time I get to this time and place on a Sunday over the course of a week, this is what I want to be a part of. And I want to go be a part of something that's different than what's out there in this world. I mean, you can't help but see, it's just crazy out there. I mean, we've lost all sense of respect for each other. We've lost all sense of filters on our language and what we say and who we say and what we do. It's just absolutely crazy. And if ever people could benefit from being in the presence of the king and in the king's quarters, it's now. It's in this time. It's in this day and age. And I feel like I'm just trying to compel this argument. But I think, truth be told, I don't have to compel that part of it. You get it. You understand it. You see exactly what I see. So you know what, friends? It's incumbent upon us. We just keep casting the seeds. We keep sending out the invitations. You know what? People who end up showing up may not be the people we think are going to be here, who we'd ever think would be here. And I can even tell you this. I've been in this church business long enough to know that from one side of the congregation to the other side, there's people who think, I don't think you ought to be here. Doesn't matter. We all got a place at the king's table. And you just never know who can show up. And when people show up, you just never know what can happen in their life. You just never know. You never know what God is going to do in their lives. So you keep casting the invitation. You do your part. You are the holder of the seeds to the kingdom. You scatter and you plant and you just keep inviting. You will never know what God will end up doing and who God will end up sending because of your efforts. Know this, you can't invite enough people. And the best part is there are people who are longing to be invited. Your work is to just go find them because the king likes to see his house full. Amen? Why don't we stand for closing prayer as the band comes back up? Well, God, I thank you for those that have opened their hearts and their minds to you. I thank you that as we file in here today, it brings joy that we're working at filling your house, at filling your ballroom, at sitting at your table. This is what brings a smile to you, and this is what causes heaven to rejoice. To know that we want to get on that path and be right with you and walk to you so that eventually we can just take the hand of Jesus, be done here, and walk across that bridge and spend an eternity with you. I thank you for the work that we do here and for what you are doing. And God, remind each and every person right now, there's more seats to be filled. So let us go scatter seats for you. We will do your bidding. We will do your work, God. And we thank you for that opportunity. We offer ourselves, this church, and these prayers to you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. We agreed and said, Amen. This up today, I just want you to pause and think about your own story in your own life. How did you wind up in church? For me, it was just because I had drugged to church by mom and dad, right? And I went begrudgingly too, I will tell you that. I've never made any bones about that. We had some nice knockdown drag outs over the years. But my story is not your story. The reality is a lot of us wind up here because somebody invited us. And somebody compelled us. They just didn't say, you come to church, that's cool, I'll see you there. No, they did something. Listen, this is making a difference in my life. And I see maybe it could help you and benefit you as well. And it does, it does. So know this as you go forth. You hold the seeds. God has given you a handful of seeds to the kingdom and says, listen, go cast these seeds freely, spread them around. You just never know where they're going to land and who it's going to affect. So friends, you hold the seeds of the kingdom. Go invite, go scatter, go plant, and compel people to come be a part of the King's party, because the King likes to see his house full. Go forth now in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.